Good evening and welcome to the Las Vegas, Nevada chapter's virtual glass blowing presentation titled, These Chiles Are Hot. Thank you for joining us. I'm Chris Lujan and I'm a member of the UNM Alumni Association Board and chapter leader here in Las Vegas. We welcome you to this unique virtual experience and hope you can take a moment to relax with us this happy hour virtual setting to learn about our presenter, Adam Frus, and his special artistic talents. I'd also like to welcome our representatives of UNM Alumni Association who are joining us this evening, and especially Margaret Ortega for helping to organize this event. In addition to the UNM representatives, we'd like to thank our local partner, Double Helix Wine and Whiskey Lounge, located here in Las Vegas at the Town Square. Tonight, they helped provide some awesome snacks, so I hope you guys can take a moment to enjoy them. And again, we thank them for their continued support of our chapter. Let's go ahead and get to learning a little bit more about Adam himself. So I introduce Adam, a fellow Southern Nevada creative and spouse of fellow Lobo alum, Rebecca Frus. Adam is a hot glass artist with a background in geology. That was a tough one, man. Got me tongue twisted there. He learned how to blow glass in 1997 and then began working professionally in 2004. He's known throughout Arizona, Nevada, and New Mexico. His glass creations are inspired by the rugged landscape of the Southwest and feature themes of mining, maps, and minerals. His work can be seen in several galleries, including the Genuine Southwestern Art and Gifts in Albuquerque and Domsky Glass here in Las Vegas. Adam's also a professional instructor of glass arts, offering courses and demonstrations at his home studio here in Henderson, Nevada. During the years of 2011 to 2016, Adam lived in Albuquerque, New Mexico with his wife, Rebecca, PhD in geology from UNM, and daughter, Elizabeth. Adam enjoys eating spicy foods, so it's no wonder that he fell in love with the New Mexican chili peppers. Shortly after he began making and selling these chilies that he'll be demonstrating for us this evening. During the presentation, members of the audience can type questions for Adam in the chat, and we'll do our best to have him answer them towards the end of the event. However, we do ask that you keep your microphone muted in an effort to limit disruption to our guests. So with a warm welcome, we'd like to welcome Adam Frus to the virtual stage. Welcome, Adam.
Excellent. Hey, thanks a lot, everybody. Thank you so much, Chris, for putting this on, and Margaret, for all your help on the IT in the background. It's pretty fun. The only one I don't actually know is Nathaniel here, but Mariah Kelling and Becky Bixby, good friends of ours from time back in the UNM, there in Albuquerque. So nice to see your faces. Anyway, so I guess we're just gonna start off and talk about, wrong side of the screen, these wonderful chilies. Now these are pretty close to life size behind me. The actual real ones that I produce are, this sort of guy, fishing man, I put it out real big for you, but in general, so it's about the right sort of scale behind. I've been making these chilies since we were there in Albuquerque, probably about 2012 I began. Producing them and stringing them up as ristras. So today I've got a little video that I've shot and put together. It's going to talk a little bit about just a quick introduction to my studio space here in Henderson, which we're really excited about. When I was there in Albuquerque, I used to always set up in the outdoors with my glass blowing studio, and that was just under a 10 by 20 car tent off the side. So it was inclement weather and all. Come back and the thing was flipped over and all these other fun, exciting adventures of working outdoors. So we're proud to have a actual glass blowing studio now here at our home, and it keeps me protected from the elements. So I guess without further ado, I'll just jump in and hit play on this, and we'll see where it goes. Oops. Ah, but I have to share my screen. So let me do that, and then we'll do that again. Here we go. We're gonna. Oh, there it is. Ah, okay. There we go. And there we go. Okay, cool. So we should have me up on the screen. Can I get a thumbs up if that's accurate? A video clip right up on the front.
You're good.
So this is the overview of the shot of the whole studio space. You can see my glass blowing equipment down to the left and the main workspaces there in the center. So from the left, there's a little black box that keeps our pipes hot. This piece in the center is called the glory. This is where I do the reheating and reworking of the glass work as I'm doing things. To the far right is a, we'll come back. I had lengthened this on another video, so I'll just pause it real quick. So here on the left side, this is the glory hole. This is where we do all of our reheating because the glass has a tendency to cool down. And if we want to continue working after about 30 seconds, it's pretty necessary to get back into the heat. The center box here is a what we call an annealing chamber. This is going to make sure that the glass is hot enough throughout the whole day that it doesn't, cold enough that it doesn't melt down into a puddle, and hot enough that it doesn't break from cooling too quickly. So this is kind of a staging piece of equipment where throughout the day I can just put another piece and another piece and another piece in, and then run a computer program at the end of the night to bring that down to temperature. Over here on the far right of the studio is the furnace, and this is really the workhorse of the entire glassblowing studio. This stays hot 24/7. I operate at about a temperature of 2,050 degrees up to about 2,100, depending on kind of what I'm making. This is all built by hand several years ago. In fact, it was constructed while I was there in Albuquerque, and it's been serving me really well ever since. And so let's go on beyond that and see what else we get. It is mobile, so I can take it off to like homes for parties and whatnot. These are typical glassblowing tools. Everything is made out of steel. There's a blowpipe on the bench, and then jacks, tweezers, and a couple of various forms of shears, which you'll be seeing me use during this video portion. Now, another really important aspect of glassblowing is what we call cold work. And this is any time that I'm going to be actually doing cutting, grinding, polishing, gluing, and assembling. Like in the case of the chili peppers, I would leave all this equipment alone, but I do a lot of tying up and other work. So the glass worker's job is not done just at the end of making an individual piece. There's often quite a bit of work to do afterwards. So this is the room where I do that. It gets real dusty and gets cleaned out pretty regularly, but some of you may recognize some wet saws and things if you've gotten involved in any lapidary. And then just a sneak peek, there are a couple things that are being worked on in the background. And the final super important portion of being an artist is some photography. So of course I've got a little setup up here so that I can take a bunch of extra pictures. Now I'm gonna have to transfer over to a second video because I had a sound issue on this one. So give me 2 seconds and we will get going out on this whole thing. We already saw that part. So we wanna go about a minute in. There you go, that's gonna be good. Okay, so. I can't see, I'd like to see all of you. There you are. Okay, excellent. So here we are at the beginning of the studio. And this is just gonna be showing off the shapes of the chiles that I make. These are blown glass pieces. In this case, this is red. And you can see that coloration in the background there and the green. So this first portion of this video is gonna clip into how I make all my colors. I order these, they come as this really large scale off in the background here. And then I crush and sift to get down to the finest. And I've found pretty good uses of all of these materials, but it is quite labor intensive. So I'm gonna take you through a little bit of what that looks like. And these are the colors that I use on all of my chili peppers. I guess in the back it's red, orange, yellow, green, blue, and purple. In this case, I'll be crushing up some green. So sifting is really a big thing. Lots of different screens. I have a 1/2 inch, 1/4 inch, and 1/8 inch. And then this little black box has a vacuum with a HEPA filter attached to it. And anything that we can do to reduce the number of breaths taken in with silica dust is the better for us. So glass artists, we're always quite concerned with our safety, eyes and ears and respiration. This is a super manual process. I've been running it like this for quite a few years. Just me and a hammer, this little scooper and some time. It takes about 1.5 hours to process a 5-gallon bucket like that. And so it's just whack, 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 dump it in. Always nice to have the vacuum going so that dust doesn't get all over the place in the studio. But this is the basic beginning of just about every glassblowing session that I have. I'll spend about 6 to 12 hours breaking color and sifting it down to get through all the 6 different colors, actually 8 different colors that I use on a regular basis. And so it's only about 5 minutes worth of time going through on all this video, and we'll just see where it's at. But this is a really important aspect for my work individually. One of the only ways that I can keep production costs a little bit lower for this particular set of work is to let myself do the labor. And so these just get sifted out. You can see a gradation between them as we go. This, the larger of Fritz that I put out just a moment ago is what I would use for my greens. And then this final one that I'm dumping off now, this is what I actually use for the stems of all the chili peppers. It's kind of a hodgepodge mix of slightly more coarse material and not. The chili peppers have been a really, really fun piece of work for me to do. It lets me step away from some of the fine art that I'm producing, which is all geologically themed, like we had talked about. I'll probably show some pictures of that later, but that's what it takes to get the color that I'm working on. First step done. Now we can go ahead and we can play. Oh no, turns out we have to clean up. It's always a really big mess in the shop. So I clean several times a day and get everything nice and moving into the actual glass blowing. So one last look at some of the colors that I like to use. And these all come from the same production factory, which used to be up in Washington State and is now hosted down over in Mexico. Okay, so here we go. This is the beginning of chili pepper production in the morning when I get out. I have to set up my colors. You recognize this one, we just put it into that bag and now here it comes. And secondary will come out to some red coloration. I use a little bit larger frit size. And by the way, frit is what we refer to anything that's crushed up colors that are being used. A tray like this is, it's a little bit more than a kilo worth of glass. And this will probably make 15 to 20 chili peppers before I have to reload that particular tray. And here we go. So takes me about 6 to 10 minutes to make a single chili, but this is a time lapse of me working incredibly quickly. And this is about an hour of time. Just to show you a little bit about how I move around in the studio space, back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, up and down from the bench. I'm not sure that I put a mile on my feet, but quite possibly in this small space, I might go about a mile over the course of the day. And this is the opening beginning. So in this case, I have this is actually a recycled pipe. You'll see me recycle the pipe throughout this video, but the first step is to get everything smoothed out so that I can get what's called a gatherer of glass. Here we're entering into the furnace. There's 80 pounds of molten glass inside of this furnace. Can't really see the level of it, but out comes very carefully portioned amount of molten glass, which gets rolled into some of that glass frit that you saw earlier. Now this sticks to the molten glass because it gets melted just a little bit on the surface. And then you're just about to see a reheat of this material. You can see it's quite chunky right now. But then once we go back, I go back into the glory hole for a reheat. Those large chunks of material will begin softening and smooth out onto the glass so that it's one uniform surface. Now, if you were to get up close to some of my chilies, you'd notice that it's not just a uniform portion of color. There are quite a few striations all throughout it. And so the process that I do is actually a hot process right here at its beginning. I let it drip off and then kind of wrap it back onto itself. And this, has a really neat portion of taking a bunch of what would be polka dots and kind of stretching them out into longer pieces. And they kind of wrap around the chilies and they give a little bit of nice texture to the pieces themselves. It's about a 5 or 6 minute reheat. Well, no, I guess the whole piece takes 5 or 6 minutes, so it must be a lot shorter. Maybe it's about a minute 20. feels like forever in there, though. And out comes a molten hot goop of glass. This is back to about 2100 degrees. You can see those striations really nicely that are created from that rotational aspect as I wrap the piece around. Now, from this point, there is no bubble in the mass. So I've just blown into the back and I've trapped some air pressure, which is going to allow a bubble to propagate into the molten glass. Quick stretch, a little bit of a blow to expand the vessel. And then using some of the tools that we've seen earlier, I'll grab onto the front and pull out, reinflate just a little bit, and then pull to the final form of the chili pepper. And I'm always using quite a bit of gravity. That last little bit that gets clipped off, I end up recycling those later. We'll talk about that. And then quickly up to what's called a jack line. These tools that I'm using here are called jacks, and I also use them to create some indents in the chili peppers that I make, just to give us a nice, let the play of light, you can see how it reflects as it goes around through all those openings and divots. Now the cut mark that was at the bottom, it's actually quite sharp right when I break it off. It's basically broken glass. So I use this little hot torch to spot heat the very tip. And there it is. You can see only the very tip is glowing. The rest of the piece chill. Now at this point, it does not look red, but that is a really nice bright red chili. That's this one over here behind me. And so a quick tap on the pipe allows that to break off. And there I am putting what's called the moil. That's the remaining glass that's on the pipe. I put that back over into the glory so that it reheats and it's ready for the next step. So at this point, I'm gathering up a small amount of glass, which will become the stem. It gets rolled in green frit for a nice surface coat and then reheated just to make it so the surface is not really granular. Quick reheat on that piece and plop down onto the top surface of the chili pepper. This is right where the cap is. So I use my shears to make small indents, kind of like the rough edges of the cap of a chili, naturally growing. I pull up and snip. It's always really fun to be able to cut glass in this moment where it's quite alive. Time-sensitive procedures. And that's kind of the name of the game for glass in general. So after that point in time, it's cooled down. I've reamed out the hole just enough that I can tie it up later. And I have to come back over. I've learned that if I don't flip that pipe over, then the material that was melting on one side will actually drip off into the hole. So flip it over before I can get back to it. And here goes the chili pepper. I'm going to pause this as it goes in. So here I'm loading up the annealer. You can see some of the other chilies that were put away during the day. Now, these are all bright red, like I said earlier. But because they're hot, the color temperature changes a little bit. So we have to wait for those colors to mature and cool down before they actually show their true colors. However, in the same case, you can see that the pale green actually shows up quite nicely, even though it's technically hotter than the chili pepper itself at this moment. So here from this stage, I just load more chili peppers in and in and in. The shelves that you see right here up above, those can come down and load in so that I can get up to 60 or 80 chilies done in a really long day. I find that I can get about 10 done an hour. So at the end of an 80 chili day, that's a pretty hefty amount for me. And that just gets closed up and reset. So at this point, I decided I'd just give you a second shot at the entire glass blowing procedure. But this time it's gonna just maintain this single camera angle, just so you can get a better appreciation for kind of what it's like moving around the studio space as we go. Like I said, this is a production set of pieces for me, the chili peppers and the ristras. I sell them at some galleries. Over in Old Town Albuquerque, is a genuine Southwest, which is right next door to the art gallery in Old Town. And they're pretty great, and they sell these chilies regularly for me. But over the course of the day, you know, 5 minutes, 5 minutes, 5 minutes, 5 minutes, get to make a whole lot. So not a lot of glass blowing for you guys to watch. So we'll take it a second chance. If anybody has any questions, you can pipe in during this section right here. I'll see if I can pull my chat up again. Oh no, I can't see my chat. Okay. Oh, I can. So here's that longer reheat. And nothing super special with my hands right there. I'm just kind of playing. It gets kind of boring, so I'm always playing around with maintaining constant rotation and fighting that carpal tunnel and the stressed out fingers. Right about now is when I'm doing that final. No, if I'm not looking real hard, I'm probably not doing the final twist yet. And here we go, back out. So I've never quite timed it, but it's probably about a minute and 20 seconds after coming out of the heat that the whole piece is finished and stable from this sort of time point. So I think I mentioned it before, but right now the glass is just a solid mass. There's no bubble inside until this moment right here where I pressurize the pipe. Now, I'm careful to keep my thumb over the back because that doesn't allow the pressure to come out. And since the glass is hot, it's just kind of like bubble gum. That bubble begins to expand. Once again, with the tweezers for a little quick pull. And every single one is a little bit different. Sometimes they pull out really nicely. Sometimes I might even have to go back and reheat. And this little clip off right here, it's kind of a fun moment. You can see the tray down below where they all end up and accumulate. So over the course of 5 or 6 days, the tray gets pretty filled. And then I segregate all the colors and I recycle those little bits later on. And here's a hot torch assembly. So this is a pretty typical glass blowing setup in general. The three pieces of equipment that you see in the background stay pretty hot. The glory turns on and off daily. The furnace stays on 24/7, and the annealer comes up and down in temperature daily, allowing me to empty out and reset and get going for the next day. Here's one more look at the break off. Quick little tap and the shock will crack through any glass, especially right there where the material was chilled and stressed. Sometimes the pipes stick together, so that was just a little technical difficulty, but remember it's a time clock. There's if this chili over here gets too cold before I get to it, then when I make the attachment, it will actually crack the glass below the chili pepper itself. So kind of a racing clock, which is quite enjoyable for me. And both of the heating chambers, the furnace and the glory, are just a little bit over 2,100 degrees. So I can use them intermittently as I go. Up and flip. Now I do some things. This is the same hook that I would make if I was going to like Christmas ornaments, but I wouldn't probably open the hole quite as large, and it would be a little bit more delicate. But same exact procedure for putting hooks. And I have hooks on the back of quite a bit of my work, which hangs, you know, chandeliers and whatnot. And so this is the conclusion of the blowing portion. Once again, going right back into the annealer. And this is where that glass will sit for the next 12 hours. Now my next couple of hours are gonna look like this. I get real tired going that fast, but it's always good to go. You can see some other interesting pieces of work in the background here. I'll pause it before it cancels out, but hanging off in the back, you can see a couple of the ristras. This is a whole series of work that I do called Bugs, which incorporates mineral specimens. And up on the corners of the wall, but in the back, I've got all these flowers that I like to put up on the metallic walls. And they've just got magnets on the back, so I rearrange them on a pretty regular basis. And we'll go back into chili peppers. I do a lot of my work as solo. I used to work a lot with my wife, Becky. She would come into the studio on a really regular basis, but ever since she picked up her job after the PhD, I get her much less frequently. She's really busy these days. But you can see here, this is a full chili pepper annealer. I think that was probably 40 peppers for the day, and some other sample pieces there in the annealer. There's the red, fully matured and nice and shiny. And I wear these gloves. These are just like hot hand gloves. The material that I'm pulling out is still about 180 degrees, so very comfortable on the bare hands. And these gloves protect me up to about 400 and some odd degrees. But it's just unload and unload and unload. I have unloaded mountains of chili peppers out of this annealer since building it back in 2011. I think the biggest weekend that I did was 120 chili peppers in a single day. That was I pushed incredibly hard that day and slept for three afterwards. But, when I'm getting ready for shows, I go in a pretty big production mode and set it all up. So here we've got the final. Now I'm in an upstairs area in my studio space, and it's time to do the final assembly on the chili peppers. You can see buckets of them around me. I use a jack chain, which I separate out into little hooks. This is a floral wire that I use to tie the peppers up, and then some sisal twine and some natural raffia. And this is just the treatment of the top of the chilies that you see behind me. So I think we're going to go into fast mode. Oh, little quality control first. You know, it's really important not to ship anything out that has a little crack or a little scratch or blemish. But tying them up just all day long. 10 chilies seems to be about the number that I really like the basic proportion on. I do them longer. I've done them the peppers all the way out to like 36 inches. Maybe 40 inches for the longest one that I've produced. I probably had about 32 chilies on that single string. So I go through and I wire up a whole bunch of them, and then I go and do the final stringing. I kind of batch it up, but in general, this time we'll just go and show it as it goes. So just a quick clip on, and then I have a certain spacing that I like to do to maintain a really uniform. In this case, I like to skip four for the lowest one, I skip three for the next, and then from there to the top, it's two at a time. I'm pretty sure I sped this up so we don't watch the half hour go by. Oh, good, there it is. I know a couple people have used to catch me at some of the art shows that I did there in New Mexico, the Rio Grande show. I sold these down in Hatch, New Mexico once. Oh no, that's right. I forgot that I edited my video and I forgot to save with the conversation. So here we'll talk out loud now. So that's the natural raffia that I use, and it's just kind of clipped into about 6 or 7 inches and bundled up around the top. And then I just tie it up. I've played with all sorts of ways. You know, the real ristras, I'm quite a bit of a realist when it comes to it. So I want things to look kind of like it would naturally and traditionally. But over the years, I've kind of developed this haystack look. And the whole thing to me ends up looking like it is the pepper. So the entire ristra ends up kind of taking the form of a single chili pepper when you're from a distance. But then as you come a little closer, is obviously made up of 10 chilies in this case. So always a fun challenge to not get all tied up and twisted. But a lot of the things that I do in the art world I get opportunities to tie myself loose and cut it all up. So just around and around and around you go. I just recently switched to this natural rope. I used to use the same green floral wire across the top. And this gets pushed back through a little loop and use a standard cord wrap technique to pull the working ends down below inside. I find that gives a pretty permanent connection. A little cleanup afterwards. And then a final haircut. So this is one of my favorite parts. I make a huge mess on the ground, but that's what brooms are for. And so all these little bits and pieces get clipped until I'm happy with the end result. I mostly want to just hide from that very top row. I like the tree and the connection points. And that just helps me establish the wide point at the top. And then just cleaning up the final little bits up here, and we are good to go. There it is, one finished chili pepper. So I think we'll take a look right here. These are the main six colors that I work with. I've done other ones in like clear. We even played with making a howler version that was all red and gray, but I unfortunately lost the image and I haven't reshot it. So that concludes some of the chili pepper blowing, the demonstrations, and we will, I believe, open it up for some questions if anybody has anything. I know most of the folks watching actually have seen me blow these probably, so let's see and say hello for a moment. It's absolutely good to see everybody. And I have and how hot is for me standing next to the glory hole? That's the one question I got for Mariah Kelly. Sorry, not Carrie. It's pretty hot. When you first begin blowing glass, like your neck, your face, and your lead arm, for me, that's my left arm, they get pretty suntanned and sunburned. You know, it is belching out 2000 degrees, and we've definitely cooked plenty of marshmallows in front of that and several hot dogs inside to a quick crisp. But depending on how far away I stand, I can really mitigate that the heat exposure that I'm up to. For just a quick second, I've got another camera angle here, which we can talk about. If nobody has any other questions about chili peppers, why don't I just slow down for a second and I'll let people talk. Well, hello there, Miss Becky. I see your face. Hello.
Hey there. We were having some internet problems.
Oh, that does happen every once in a while, but we've all gotten used to them.
Can I ask you how big your new studio is? It looks humongous.
It is kind of humongous. We joke because it's got a little larger footprint than our house, but the house is split level and this one is not. It's 30 by 50 is the footprint of the whole shop that I built. And then the studio space that you saw mostly in the video, it's 40 by 30 on the main shop floor. And then I have the back 10 is broken into that cold working shop, a bathroom, and then the upstairs rooms where I was doing the assembly of this chili peppers. And so it took quite a while to get the whole thing built. And I'm incredibly happy to be indoors again.
Pretty fantastic.
Yeah.
Chris. Quick question. I'm intrigued about the potential parallels between your expressions through glasswork and your background in geology. Both have notions of pressure, temperature, movement, and really just taking things and reconfiguring the arrangements around of these atoms to make something special. Is there a parallel, or am I reading too far into this?
No. With the chili peppers, there is really no parallel other than that, you know, it's everything is physics. So, you know, heat temperatures and whatnot. But I can turn my camera around and I'll show you a couple of other pieces that are relatively new that I'm working on.
I guess I was talking more as your interest in glass blowing in general, right? Like, just how did you get to this point? Because it's a really cool intersection between your interests.
Yeah, so when I was younger, age 16 is when I first started blowing glass. And, you know, getting to work with such a unique material, it's a little dangerous, it's hot, it's just crazy cool. And that was really, really a big love, but I was not sure about being an artist full time for my life. And so I decided when I went to university, I wanted to study geology. And of course, you know, volcanoes in general. I do some volcano work. Oh, I'm still sharing a screen. That's funny. I will, I'll just go ahead and pull some up real quick because I have a couple of pictures here that we can look at. Volcanoes were really the first thing that that took me in. And this is a solid piece of glass that I've made. You can see this, right? Everybody thumbs up? Okay, cool. Just making sure that's coming along. So here I'm a conversation about molten earth underneath, which is kind of one of those first things that drew me in. And because I was blowing glass at the same time as learning geology, I really kind of started meshing the two quite together and started replicating and making things that I would see in my textbooks or find in the field. I do some crystals here in the center. These two pieces are some of the early crystal pieces, which I did, which ultimately turned into really large scale jewelry. But I was trying to replicate some of the things that I dealt with. Mapping was one of my favorite subjects. And so this series of pieces, I call them journey vessels. And these are brand new. I just submitted these ones to my gallery there in Old Town. So these are available to be seen if you were to head that direction to Genuine Southwestern Arts and Gift. And these feature a topographic map below, and then the profile if you were to hike along the way. So this peak that's right here on this white piece corresponds to this peak with a small dip saddle up to another peak here. And so this is a brand new series for me. I'm really, really enjoying making them. These are two-tone pieces, color on the interior with the color on the exterior, and then I'm doing all grinding and polishing to remove some of the excess to develop some of the patterns here. Mining. So when I was in Albuquerque, I got really, really excited about going out into the field and kind of experimenting and doing some time. This is out in the Zuni Mountains at one of my favorite mines. This was the Bonita mine. It was just a portion of the Zuni Mountains that had really good fluorite exposures. And so I spent a lot of my time there traveling out and being in that realm. I was active with the Albuquerque Gem and Mineral Club for quite a few years. And sort of these experiences are the things that really combined in to get me going. These natural landscapes, this is out by Cabazon. So I would go out here and find fossils. This is a good locality for shark's teeth, calcite minerals, and every once in a while an ammonite if you're really lucky. Now I do other work too. This is some of the sculpted work that I make. So nothing geologically themed right here, but it really lets me push some of the boundaries. These are just drinking buddies, drinking vessels, and here's one that he gets cut off with the funny screen. But anyway, these are a really good piece that I like to make. It keeps me challenged, and they're kind of more on the whimsical sort of side. Do flowers along the way. Oh, back to me mining. I didn't quite get my pictures all in order. This is down at the Blanchard mine in New Mexico as well. Here we are going for fluorite with my good buddy Rex, who's next right there next to me. So here, this was kind of the first set of pieces that I developed. I call them elementals, where I really wanted to showcase some of the things that I was pulling out of the earth. In fact, the previous picture, these linerite specimens from the Blanchard mine, they came from there. So this was me saying, let me take a body of glass and actually showcase some mineral specimens next to it. And that looks like that was the end of those pictures. All right. I guess we just have that. So this is the rest of that series. Now I've done probably 50 of these pieces of both varieties. I do these taller elementals in the background and the shorter ones, which I called vugs. And a vug is kind of a geological term that's kind of a hollow space, and it happens to be where most of your good crystals grow. So if you're out in the world looking and you find a vug, it's a happy day. I hope that explains a little bit about that. And I am trying to navigate through here. Screen sharing. I want to stop my screen. And I will go over and I'll show you a little bit extra. There's Miss Mariah. Hello. I see your face. Switch around. Here we go. USB camera. And I have to change my background. Choose my virtual background. There we go. Start video. Okay, so this should be a little bit better. Okay, so here we have a couple of pieces, just a mineral specimen, just to kind of flavor out. And then I'm doing some new pieces that actually I'm basically lithifying glass. So from the outside, this is what it looks like. This is just sand and glass mixed together and then melted all into one cohesive unit. And then on the interior, I have what used to be something similar to this drinking glass, which I've kind of buried inside of this piece, and I'm letting it basically preserve. So the concept is, what happens when we go away and we've left all these pieces of glass that are gonna sit around forever? It'll get buried and then reheated and turned into something cool. So these are something new that I'm working on. You can see my table in the background here is just literally filled with experiments and fresh pieces that are coming in. And then additionally with the geology, this piece in the back is something that I really like. It's part of a larger series. And I'm making fault blocks, sandbox modeling. So this is a small sequence of layered brown and purple glass, which has been shifted in and faulted. So we get development of a couple of neat faults. And then I added some more colors and pushed those up against as well. So there's two sequences of faulting involved there. And then I slice these, and these are going to be mounted up onto the wall. One of the fun things about this are these little pieces right here. So these are the tails when I go to cut a chili pepper. So this is that little portion that you saw me pulling off when I'm actually stretching the chili pepper. And they just break off and accumulate. But I've started taking them and actually recycling them. So if you look a little bit closer, there's a hollow space right in here, which is where I like to imagine that if I was living and going into this terrain, that's where I would go mine. And that those hollow spaces are created by incorporating some of these tails. So that was a tail sitting here, and there's one in there as well. So it's kind of a fun way to recycle the glass, which if I didn't make the chili peppers, I wouldn't have a million tails sitting around to recycle, and I'd have to be using fresh material the whole time. So that's something that a lot of people are always really quite interested in, is that aspect of, can you reuse your glass? And for the most part, the answer is no, we like using fresh glass. But every once in a while, I get really lucky and I come across an idea that allows me to incorporate some of the tailings and the things that are left behind. So that's good for combo and that. Let's flip me back around here. And yeah. Oh, hey, everything's behind me. No funny screen. It's just a bunch of drinking glasses, fish, all sorts of other neat sculptures, but I'm gonna go back to my cool video screen. if anybody else has any questions they want me to talk about, I would be glad to hear them. That works. Am I back to my, I should be back to my, yeah, all right, cool. Anyway, so not a huge UNM alum. Now, who here is actually, everybody's here in Albuquerque. Well, Mariah, you're out.
Yeah, I'm out in Santa Rosa right now.
There you go.
Back and forth, but today I'm in Santa Rosa. Hi, it's good to see you. Yep, thanks so much.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's great to see you as well. And Becky, I'm sure that you're still in Albuquerque. Plugging away. How's UNM treating you these days? Busy?
Not bad. It's the end of the semester, so we're all happy.
Excellent. And you're graduating a bunch of students. How many students did you have this
season? I had two finished in December.
Excellent.
Two working right now. Probably be finished in December this next year.
I think it's a blast. It's always fun to see. There's Becky giving us some claps on that one. Big shout out to all the graduates, always. This is an exciting time period. Facebook gets just filled up with all of our friends who are graduating or have their children are now graduating sometimes, and it's kind of crazy to see, but there it is. Anyway, so I don't know, Chris, how long do we want to run? I'm plenty happy to just sit and chat for a bunch.
Yeah, the floor is open again. Really appreciate you making this available to us to be able to get a better glimpse of how you do your work, how the process is fulfilled, and really just things that oftentimes we probably take for granted when you look at what it takes to make something like that. I mean, I have a little bit of appreciation from it from my side, having seen, you know, how some of the glass that gets integrated into our architectural projects comes to be. So I'm really intrigued to hear how other folks observe it as well. But floor's open. I know you do have a shop that's set up online. If you're not able to get to a gallery through Etsy, right? You're represented on there if anybody's interested in your products.
Yeah, that's true. So most of the chili peppers, you can always contact me directly through my website, frusglass.com. And I believe that we've got that up on the UNM Facebook page, but I can type it over here into the chat as well. And then on the Etsy pages, the shop name that I go through is my last name and company. So Frus Glass is the shop. It's just all one word. But you can search for me, Adam Frus. And there are about six different items that I sell through Etsy. But the chili peppers, that's my primary way of getting them out there.
Sure. There was some questions a couple of days ago. We're talking to some fellow alum. They're discussing about customization on top of the chilies. You know, they were wondering, gosh, could you somehow get the UNM alumni logo as almost a Coldwell or something to that chili at the end for branding opportunities if somebody wanted to use that for gifts or ideas? How would you customize something afterwards like that?
Well, I tell you what, we'll do it right now. Give me 2 seconds. I'm going to disappear and then I'm going to come back and we'll grind it on right now.
Oh, awesome. That's awesome.
He's so great, isn't he?
Yeah.
So live. I think he's going to grind. I do know that we have been thinking about that, just so you know, Chris.
Love it.
We can think about maybe even tying into the Alumni Association. And I know we were hoping to talk with Margaret a little bit, see if maybe we couldn't help with a fundraiser, maybe over homecoming.
Certainly.
And if it was through the chapter or through the whole association.
I think that would be a great opportunity to pair things up. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Right. So usually I use a Dremel, like a rotor. It's so funny when it wants that background thing. I'm going to switch over to my other screen real quick and get rid of my virtual background so that it will not do that. And okay. So a lot of times I use a rotary Dremel, but in this case, I'm just going to use one that has an oscillating tip, carbide. And like, if I was going to do a customization right along the crown of the piece, and so forgive the vibrational noise as we turn it on. But And so then with a quick piece, there's just UNM out there. And like sometimes this is, if I put a signature on my pieces, a lot of times that would go right here as well. So the name, the date, I want to get more specific to like the trademarked logo. Mm-hmm. And I would just need the artwork. That can be sandblasted. And so the sandblasting would give a little bit form for the UNM logo.
Awesome.
Year, something like that up at the top. And then a lot of times if I'm putting them together, I like to do them as a red and a green together.
For sure. For sure. Margaret, if you're still listening, you know, we start looking at some of these chili roasts that we're looking to get back in person, hopefully later this year, or the roast by post, you know, some different opportunities for collaboration, I think.
Yeah, definitely.
Very so cool. I know my wife and I have joined over at the Carlitos Burritos quite a few times and gotten a huge quantity of peppers from there.
Yes, sir.
And so that would be a thing, considering that my glassblowing studio is mobile. You know, there's a possibility of even bringing it out and doing live demonstrations. But that's something I would have to work together with. I can't remember the gentleman's name that runs that place, but he's pretty open to things. David, you said?
Yeah, yep.
Yeah, I thought I remember.
Guy.
Yeah, it's always been really neat to be able to go out there and pick up chilies instead of driving all the way back to Albuquerque, which I love to do. Yes. I love to do. And I feel like there's another trip coming up really soon here. Oh, hi, my brother's on there. Oh, that's fun.
Awesome.
So, yeah. So no other big questions coming through. But in general, I'd like to say that our time in Albuquerque was huge. That's probably some of the biggest formative years for me as a glass artist. My time in Arizona was really good, but it was really during the time there in Albuquerque that I was able to stretch and spread my wings and develop the experiences which have now kind of all come together in most of my work. Plus the chili peppers become a really great bread and butter piece for me. And so I make quite a few of these every year. Hundreds and hundreds of them, really, and I will make them as long as we can go. I only wish I could eat them. I don't know how hot these ones would be, but probably these orange ones right here would be a
Scoville pretty glass scale.
Yes. Yeah, that's right. No chomping on these ones.
Right. I have to ask, as the background has a hot air balloon, have you blown any hot air balloons?
You know what? I have not. I have some good friends over at Robin's Ranch. They're in. They're just outside of Albuquerque. Maybe they're in Santa Rosa. Anyway, they do quite a few of the hot air balloons, and I've thought about it. Uh-huh. I've made a lot of cactuses, and quite honestly, the cactus would be the same exact thing, except I wouldn't put it on a base. I'd just have to make that little bulb underneath. It's a pretty cool shape in general, and I would like to make some, so. If we need to commission some, that's always up available. I would use what's called an optic mold to create all those cool ridges down the side. And
okay.
Maybe a big cane pickup to get something really specific.
Okay.
But yeah, our time, and we used to have those balloons would fly over us every day, you know, just about being there on the Rio Grande. And yeah.
Great. Well, again, thank you so much for your time and for everybody joining us this evening. Really cool opportunity to do something that, you know, while I'm sure it'd be fun in person, honestly, I think this was a great medium by which to share this experience, to really show the sequencing of it also. Thank you so much, and appreciate your generosity with your time.
That's excellent. Well, as COVID restrictions lift and the world gets back to normal, I'm sure that I'll be available, and I'd love to do some more, reach out and work with the UNM alum. And so maybe getting out there for live demonstrations at the chili roast, that could really possibly happen. I think that would be really fun. And if you'd ever like to reach out, and in general, the UNM alum, if anybody would like to reach out and come here for private studio sessions, you know, glassblowing lessons or just tours through, I'm always available for contact on that. You can get me through my website, www.frusglass.com. That's FRUSGLASS.com. And you can do some ordering and things like that if you'd like any of the products that you see through Etsy. And outside of that, I just want to say thank you so much to Chris Lujan and Margaret Ortega as well for all of your help along the way, getting us ready for this. And so.
Certainly. All right, everybody. Well, on behalf
thank you so much for your time.
Yes, on behalf of the UNM Alumni Association, thank you for joining us, and go Lobos, everybody.
Go Lobos.
Go Lobos, absolutely.